Okay, here we go. Let me make sure this thing is on. Okay. All right, we got 22 people in the house. It's a very special broadcast. I see Hung's here. All I can think of is when we just did the show and she said what she said about when she sees adults crying. So hopefully then none of that will happen. So just make everything up as we go, as usual, and then just doing the show with Robert. And I just want to share something that I had written a few weeks after Franco transitioned. I just want to share it and just to start things off and just tell you a little bit about what this broadcast is about. So Franco and I, we would meet sometimes in Zoom privately and just have conversations. And the last time we did it was on September the 21st, 2021, which was about 10 days before we did our last show. And we did about 52 shows together, probably about 60 collaborations altogether with Soulogy Fest. About 5 minutes into it, we both just said we should record this, not really thinking we'd share it, although he suggested later maybe we should put this out. In fact, that was his intention. And I talked to Kimberly a couple of weeks ago, and we found it, and she sent it over to me, and I said, yeah, let's go ahead and share it. It's a little bit different. I didn't watch all of it because I don't really have the capacity to sit there and watch myself talk. And what's different about this one, it's probably about 50-50 on the talking. And in the beginning, I talked quite a bit, like for 4 or 5 minutes, because it was a personal meeting. So I was a little bit out of sorts, and I was just trying to, find some alignment with Franco's assistance. And so I'm a little bit, imbalanced at the beginning of it. And so once we get past that part, which you probably won't find as painful as I did, but then it flows a little bit better. So I just want to start off by sharing something with you that I wrote, I feel, in collaboration with him. And it just kind of sums up how I feel or what I gained from the experience in collaborating with him from the other side of the veil. And if you'll just allow me, I would really appreciate it. And then we'll get into it. Hello, everybody. Test, test, test. I'm not asking how no more. There's no need to talk about it. I know the truth's been outed. We don't have to try so hard. We finally found the flow. It doesn't move so slow. We surrendered to the lies. Zero point in sins. We got no choice, you know. We have to let it go. we have to die again. If a seed's to grow, I don't need to know. I don't need to know the whys, my friend. I don't have to lie no more. Look how far down we'd gone. When our hearts ran cold, walls built over doors, look how far we come. We don't have to die no more. Death is not a chore. It's so good to be alive. Man, she makes me shine. Blows my mind. Every breath's the high, 'cause love don't have to try. It feels so fine, you know I'm in. I guess you know it's time to live. We're the genies and the djinns. You know it's time to give. We found the fallen angels, making friends with strangers. I think I might just die again, so I can resurrect. I swear I'll do my best, endless chances will I get. I'm my only bet. We're living dreams without regrets. Come on, let's get it off our chest. We can fix this mess. We can love till nothing's left. We see what glory is. We see what's glorious. It ain't so serious. She knows you did your best. You know life is not a test. The golden child, it never left. It's still inside of us, can't you see? Winning don't exist. Everybody shifts. I hope you get my drift. We got this world, it's on a string. We're tied to the sacred wedding ring. Even silent angels sing. You are the only thing. You are everything. You are everything. The one and only thing. Winning's nothing, and nothing's everything. I came and left with you. I always find you at the end. To grow love is how and why. We'll always do it once again. Thank you. So let's get to it. And thank God I don't have to look at Hung telling me, why'd you start crying? But here we go. Here we go. Let me just pull it up. This is runs about 90 minutes.
Okay.
There you go. Oh, there you go.
All right. I'm going to pause it until you.
I just got it. Yeah, I'm getting full confirmation. Yeah, Morgan and I, we recorded the last three sessions we did together, and we ended up putting two out, and then I did a live. She did a post on, I think, the second one or the first one, and then I did a live explaining it. It was very interesting. But anyway, yeah, I just think it pushed the button. Yeah. So, yeah, because I was thinking that right when we started talking, it's a lot different talking and there's not, you know, an audience, right?
Right.
So that's kind of cool. That captures what in, you know, in some kind of, nonverbal way, what I am, what I understand. It's not, there's no words to it. And maybe if I jump into a little personal, then we can, you know, then we can go from there and start talking about these subjects and kind of lose the, idea that we're actually recording it. But so one of the things, and we'll go back to these subjects. I think it's real important, but I just don't want to be like conscious. I think, you know, to be more spontaneous. So one of the things, like I was telling you, I obviously have worked with Morgan, this primarily in the early years where I was, and what you said earlier was right on the money. When I started Soulogy and I got all the, you know, and I brought it all, came back. I was like, I have a soul. I am not just a human being. So I didn't have the as you so eloquently and perfectly summed me up. I didn't have the love and honor, respect. I did have it, but I only had it up to the point of my awareness of what exactly the human contribution was and is. And so obviously that's changed. And so I'm the biggest cheerleader on the planet for the human being. And also see its place, our place, however you want to put that, in the universal. And it's phenomenal. And I wouldn't want to be anywhere else. I set up this life and I really knew this pretty quick after what we call the traumas or the dark nights of the soul, or during it actually. And it was beautiful. You know, these dark crevices, you know, I prefer in all incarnations, I believe, to go into the extremes. You know, to if you get up on a ladder, take care of everything you can while you're up there before you come back down and move it, right? I mean, you want to get the most out of it. So I like to
flash. And I fully agree with you, because that's the imprint I see from your soul. Definitely. You're not going to waste any moment, and you're going to use any opportunity that you stage fully. And then when you feel done with it, because you pushed it to the max, and then you'll move on to something else.
Yeah. Yeah. It's kind of cool. It's a little bit. Yeah. But so here's the thing. And we can flow into the other stuff, because it's all related. So we were talking about the attachment that has now gone to a different level. In so many words, you know, we all had attachment to traumas and, you know, and all that stuff and this and that. And like I said previously, before we started recording, I don't really have any hangups for any incarnation. And I'm aware of quite a few of them on Earth. What I did have, or what I've come to understand, and what I did was I put certain markers throughout my path to both experience to the extreme, and then also to simultaneously help me to remember, and it works like a charm. But there's a part of this that I've sat with for years, and it's pre-Earth incarnation, but I see them all as the same thing, really. And I'm talking about the galactic wars. I'm talking about my role in those time periods. And I've long since, you know, 5 years back, brought in all aspects of dark and light. But I put something in. I don't think anyone does anything to me. That's just the way I operate, because it's me doing it to me. I put something in, I believe. I can say this. If I had to say, you know, hey, if you say this is true and it's not, you're not going to be here. I'd have to say it's true, okay? Because I trust my intuition. I trust my soul. So there's something going on with my lineage, or my history, really my history in these galactic wars, which I had about 2 years of downloads back in 2014, 2015, just every day, right? And of course it was simultaneous, no linear time. And, you know, so it took me a while to figure out, but again, it was the wordless that I understood. And so, you know, in these conversations that we have with our aspects, which is really a conversation with myself, okay, I laid out a riddle or a puzzle. You know, it's like a what are those called, scavenger hunt? And there's a piece, and it's an important piece. And the reason I put it in, I guess you could call it like a memory block.
Right.
The reason I put it in is because I could not have that awareness or code or memory and function to the level of efficacy, you know, that I desire to, in other words, it would minimize the potential for what I came here to do, or part of what I came here to do in terms of service. So I've been looking for this morsel and I've been having these conversations with my aspects with myself. And I understand two things. One, that it's time for me to remember this. And part of the reason for that is because I would not only would it have messed things up in terms of minimizing the potential, but at the same time, I just wasn't ready for it. Mm-hmm. Even though I accept my divinity and I accept my limitlessness, the human condition had to get to a certain point of elevation or alignment before it could take this on, no different than energy coming into the body at a physical level and so on. So I tuned in with you, and you probably know this. I tuned in with you from time to time. Most of the time it's me. Sometimes I'll bring in family like you, especially as time's going on, because to me, it's a straighter line to the main line of the infinite intelligence. And so I tuned in and it was like, again, it's all wordless for me, but it was like, is there something that you know that I don't, that you know I don't know that might be in this that I'm describing to you? But also at the same time, and that's just a futile attempt for a human trying to explain it. But at the same time, something happened the other day. When we were doing the show, and I knew, because I was getting sick, and I just knew it seems like every one of them is the best one, but there was something really, with the dates and without the energy, and with September, something was happening. I knew I could feel it in my soul, in the bones of my soul. And so we had that great exchange. It was just phenomenal. Everything was phenomenal in that show. But at one point, you mentioned, I think you were mentioning a story. You were mentioning a story about an experience that you had in the context of our conversation, where you talked about regression, specific to, I believe, in that story, was to, I was this in a past life and I was that in a past life. This doesn't feel like that. This feels very galactic. It was a very long, it was a very, very long set of incarnations with a very embedded purpose that took a long, long, long time, a very important role, and I don't mean that to give myself any credibility. It's not about that. It's about the depth, which fits my soul, right? That fits my soul. So in order to go into the extreme, if you go in and you embed yourself as the deepest of the deep, obviously it's going to take a lot to pull it out. So, but I know it's important. I don't know where I'm going with this. I've never done a regression. I don't even work with people in that capacity. When Morgan and I work together, typically now what happens is she'll facilitate and I'll be the one that goes in. And then psychically, obviously we're experiencing the same thing, 99% of the time. So I don't have any problem tapping in to anything I want to. But this, there's a morsel out there that I've left, and I hit it so well that I can't find it. And so it's out of the norm for me to even discuss something like this. Not because, I'm proud and all that, but because this is what I know. I just know that I always find my way, even if it's at the 11th hour in the 59th minute. So having said that, that's just information I'm giving you and to play with, for us to play with. And then, of course, to lead into things that might be, as the individual goes, so goes the collective. So I would imagine there's something, maybe not in the process of, say going through a regression or the discussion, but certainly what is activated in me will then be translated in collaboration, as we've done many times, as into, you know, what I, what I'm, you know, what I'm here to do. So anyway, I'll hand that over to you.
Well, where do we unpack that?
I don't know. That's why, you know, it's funny because I said to Morgan, I'm going to reach out to Franco. And she said, why? And I said, it wasn't like a bad thing. She goes, well, is there any, you know, and I said, well, I want to see what's going on with him. And, you know, we don't really get a chance to do that. And I really enjoyed, you know, spending time with you and Kimberly. And I told you how I felt about the two of you. But I said, I don't know why. The rest of it, because at that point it was just that thing that comes in and goes, oh, you need to go here, you need to go there. And then when I would lay down, sometimes I'll, you know, like I said, I'll pull up my team or what I know is, you know, and then sometimes people pop in, you know, and mirrors pop in, aspects pop in. So it, I just put it all together, connected the dots. Every, you know, always multiple purposes. So, you know, I just threw that in there.
Well, the thing is, while you were talking, that came up, and this is tuning into your own self as your soul and so forth. And I mean, you've already played with a lot of it, and you're coming to a deeper realization of what you're looking for. And so the piece that's missing is not really missing. It's just that you've been skirting around it, you know, of sorts, because you're already dabbling with it. And we started talking about it earlier, and that was the fact of coming to a point where you see yourself, no reference point of any previous incarnation, because the way it actually works, this is what your higher self is saying, the way it works is that we jump in, and you have this template within yourself. Wherever you go 150%. I mean, you're diving in, you play the role 100% without any dragging. So, and this also relates with people, because, you know, sometimes people start to awaken and says, well, you know, I was a goddess, or I was, you know, this or that, or the fact that, you know, I used to run planets, or that I blew up things, or whatever it is. So there's a lot of different identification that people drag in. But the point here is, wherever you are, you dive in. You know, and so if you're on planet Earth, you are the human. Now, you're no longer the dragon, you're no longer this, you're no longer anything, you're the human. But what you come here to do is unpack a new state of human, okay? Never to reduce what we call the human, never to say, oh, you know, I was this, and I got to bring this here. You're not bringing anything here. You're just your own overall consciousness that you've gained, your skill set, but you're not here to replicate anything of anywhere else that you've gone. First of all, because things are changing all the time. Second of all, is that wherever you are, and I've had to learn this the hard way too, because I was kind of, you know, being the alien sort of thing. That gives some perks and whatever else because of the fact of what you can access. But I had to learn how to be the human. And, you know, when I say learn to be the human, is to dive in and be the human, okay? And then unpack it to another level of that experience. So this is what is the piece, and say, okay, I'm in Todd's, what I refer to as Todd's body, but I'm human. And how do I now shift away from any association from anything that I've done before? And even if I blew up planets, or, you know, was in the galactic wars or anything of that nature, those were in those roles. But right now, what can I bring to the table to really upgrade this whole experience? Because I'm 150% in here. And this is one of the reasons why you dive into things. This is one of the reasons, and this is not just you, there's many other people too, all of us to some degree or another. We dive in and say, okay, well, let me learn what the current state of the human is. And then now, with all my skill sets and everything that I've learned and things that I'm experiencing along the way, because your consciousness is always expanding, your learning is constantly expanding, how can I now bring the human to the next level and not make any limits whatsoever? So this is what your higher is saying. And that's, it's been in your face.
I had to laugh about this because you know how you ask the question and you get the answer before, but this didn't happen that way. I threw it out there, and in the first five words, I got it. And this needs to be explained. I think that's important, but I got it. It's it's hilarious, actually. But it's the same thing. It's this. It's just an over-identification. It's the imprint, and because it wasn't like verbatim related to, or relayed to me, like piece by piece, story by story, I just felt the imprint. And actually, I guess in the reality of it, I had to speak it before I could release it. But yeah, you absolutely just fully explained that. Especially, I love this last part, because this is exactly, you know, how sometimes you know things, which is kind of hard to believe with me, but you know things, but you can't say them. Mm-hmm. You know, it happens with Morgan sometimes. Now it just happened with you. Like, I know this, it's like on the tip of my mind's tongue, and then you just said it, which was, in a nutshell, you're fully in the incarnation, in this case human. You fully forget everything so you can fully understand what this is. And then, and only then, once you, I would just put it in my words, once you, as happened to me 10 years ago, I am a soul. This I know, you know, this is not me. Once you get to that, on that track, then you start to pull in, you know, consciously and not, you start to pull in your the gifts or the abilities or whatever that aren't you, but certainly the tools that you have to enhance the human experience, which is exactly where I am at today.
Yeah. And the thing is too, like all of these powerful experiences that you've had with Morgan, with yourself, these connections into the galactic, into the astro, into all of these realms, that's actually just stimulating that forceness within you. And at the same time, it's also reminding you that as much as you're here 100% to really upgrade it, but you also are that multidimensionality. You are also all of that, but not as an association. That's your toolbox. It's like going into your garage and you got full of tools and whatever else, you know. You're not going to say, well, I'm the tools. I'm going to say, wow, I got all these tools. Let me fix what I'm here to fix. Or in this case, upgrade, repair, do whatever. And that's what you're here to do. So you're not here to repair. You're here to advance humanity. Mm-hmm. Even the star seeds that come in and so forth, they're coming in very specifically tuned for one purpose, is to embody and to upgrade every part of it. So one of the reasons that you came here, this is your higher self had said before, besides what I just said now, your work was to nudge humanity to evolve, to become.
Well, that must be a salient point. So, that was a hell of a whistle.
Yeah, it was the actual phone. I didn't realize it was in the room here. Kimberly will answer it. But if not, I'll call back. I think it's my daughter. I'll call her later. But let's say, yeah, so you're here to nudge, as many of us have come, and really go into it. And the only way you can assist humanity, and when I say assist, maybe that's not the right word, to be part of humanity in its evolution and evolving state of being and expansion, is not to go into the human experience and then create tears. Well, here's the human, here's me. Mm-hmm. No, it has to merge. And then all of it works together. And that's what's instrumental. A lot of people, as they're so-called awakening, becoming more aware, they create tears.
Yeah.
And that's that has to, if you do that, that's great. That's temporary. But the thing is, and it's just an experience, but the self-realization is when you dissolve the tears, and then it's you embodying this, and you are fully here. You're not saying, well, I got to go into this other dimension for me to feel at home. No, you need to bring the home wherever you are, because you are, because again, we're not leaving anywhere. We're still in the field. We're still everything, but no association. A lot of people look at their lives and say, okay, you know, I played this role, then I played that role. I was homeless. I was this, I was that, whatever it was, or that, you know, I had this traumatic situation and so forth, or I had this in my past life or whatever it is. That's an association, and the process that we're going now is to purge all of that so that you can actually be fully open to design whatever you design as you go along, rather than still having that. And that includes whatever you played on, whatever dimension, whatever realm, whatever, you know, parallel version of anything.
Yeah.
And even because we have multiple facets of ourselves, like, but those are all simulations. But where's your focal point? Your focal point's here, because that's right. This is where the key is. This is where the other ones are just simulations. And those are, you know, what do you call it? What's the word? Oh, lost the word now. I just added it in my mind. But parallel worlds, or these parallel worlds, they only exist to go and experiment there. But this is the one that counts. This is that's the right. one that you're that's playing right. an active role in.
Yeah, this makes perfect sense. Energetically, it's like formless in the form.
Yeah,
to me, right? So it's that formlessness in the form, and yeah, this totally. I'm totally in alignment with this. I mean, I understand this. This is why I've been having for a couple of weeks, as the energy has expanded, these conversations with me, as I see it, and it's been about the human. It's been about, you know, hey, these missions are just messages, like you said. These missions are reminders and cookie crumbs for the trail home. The real thing is here right now. Like I always say, you know, who do you want to be with? What do you want to do? You know, I mean, it's that singularity of all those formless aspects, so to speak, in this form. Now let's go play, kind of thing. I think the other thing that we didn't catch on this recording, which I think would be important for people if it's shared, you know, which I'm totally open to, you know me. I was telling you that 2 days ago, I went through several hours of, I don't know what you would call it, you know, whatever state between delta and awake state, you know, where you're in and out. And a lot of people that come on the show that are posting, hey, I'm getting massive information and massive expansion and upgrades, and it's all happening at the same time. That's what it was. But at one point, and I think that was a very good explanation what you gave. I told you that I had a tail come out of me. Came out of my tailbone, and I said, wow, is that a reptilian tail or a dragon tail? So I said to myself, it doesn't even matter. I let it go. But I didn't realize the importance of what was happening until you explained it. So I think that'd be a good thing to go over again. Why is that happening?
So the thing is, as much as we are purging any identification, attachments, and so forth to anything that we've experienced in this human life, and anything that we've carried from a collective or lineage or anything of a nature, we're also going through the same purging of anything, any form, any dimension, anything that we have in one way or another experience prior, so that we do not have an older identification. Because one of the things, like I was saying earlier, is that any form of identification actually disconnects you or reduces your capacity of your wholeness, which is basically your sourceness. And then it also, that association also doesn't allow you to fully embody the human, which is one part. The next part of it is the fact that as long as we're identifying with anything that was experienced before, you're still experiencing, you're identifying not only of an old role, but an old state of consciousness, an old state of evolution or an expansion, because that may have happened, whatever. You say an example, 100 years ago, well, where was that particular race that you dropped into at that time 100 years ago? Where was that planet's frequency at that point in time? What was what you learned there at that time? Where was the galaxy and the universe in state of consciousness and alignments and so forth? So it doesn't serve. And this is the thing is, so what's happened is there are different identifications and links. So you will have that. And what you said was exactly what clears it. It's like, oh, a tail. Great. Doesn't matter if it was this or that. You're experiencing it. And then it's just going. It's going because you're not going to associate with it anymore. It's the same thing as I was saying, you know, associating with the feminine, the masculine, the, you know, I was a goddess, or I was a, you know, a warrior, you know, I fought galactic wars, or I did this, and then associate with that I was a powerful being. What's happening each time? You're doing two things. One, you're disconnecting from the human and glorifying or creating tears. And the second part is, once you're in that state, you're not really fully doing what you came here to do, which is basically upgrade and expand the human.
Yeah. And it sounds, and this is interesting, because I had brought this up to you. It's when we first started talking before we started recording, and I was saying, it's interesting sitting in this chair watching these people that have been out there and had brought in certain aspects of themselves to the table to help remind us. Mm-hmm. When you say that, okay, so because now I understand this, and I have a great question. This is fun doing this together. So I get this, right? I get the imprint that I had, you know, so to speak, that this little thing that wouldn't go away was actually an attachment, an over-identification with my involvement in whatever it was, in this case, say Galactic Wars. But that's no different than me being hell-raising and in addiction and in mired in the muck by the human perspective, my over-attachment, over-identification to that. So it's really the same thing. Now, what I find very interesting this is to me, the street smarts of the soul. And that is that, let's say that, I have an essence or a dragon or whatever come in and materialize in front of me, which has happened with me and other people. And it says to me, I am you. I am the golden dragon, no disrespect to any of my aspects or any of the universe. And this is what we're going to do together, or whatever the case is. But instead of, regardless, so let's say I align with that and I go function in certain capacity and follow through on this guidance, which is really me. But if I get attached to this dragon, then one, like you said, I'm losing focus on the human, which means I'm not embodying to the potential I can. Okay. And then and two, or 1A is what you said about I'm not fully in my purpose. But the interesting thing to me is that if I'm attaching myself to Mother Mary, to Jesus, to this and that, I'm actually diminishing my connection with infinite intelligence, where I actually, you know, from this point, I'm thinking, oh, wow, I'm really connected, but I'm actually limiting myself. And I think that's a really great point. And that also succinctly describes
what I'd been, what I was telling you when we got on about sitting in this chair and watching what's happening, because I'm watching, and it looks like it's becoming, which is a very good sign, in my opinion, to see people who have been in prominent roles, I would say, who have had profound contributions to supplying code and so on, but watching them, you know, we think that the governments and the religious institutions and financial and legal and all that's going to be deconstructed, and it is, but it's also these belief systems or these impediments to our growth, these over attachments with these vehicles or aspects that have basically been part of our remembrance. So it's interesting because I'm watching people slowly it's starting to happen, most, from my opinion anyway, unconsciously, but with some expanding level of consciousness, that these things are just like these institutions, that they're not going to be, they're not us. They, you know what I mean? And I know you understand that, but you can probably say it better, but they're not us. This is our toolbox. Like you said, this is our toolbox, no different than any experience that we have here on earth. Right. I mean, if I get traumatized and I get, you know, somebody brutalizes me, perpetrates me in my body or whatever the case is, that's not me. That's information. And so this, I have a question in regard to this one question. And then also in terms of like what I just described, that we can go back to, but in terms of what you were talking about, I've heard you say home planet. Okay. Now, if, and I believe what you're saying,
home frequency.
That's better. Yeah. Okay. So home, a planet is really just a symbolic of the, and that explains that, you know, where I was going with that.
Yeah.
Well, where does that fit in? But you just said it perfectly, because I get that. Yeah. You might want to explain that a little bit, though.
Yeah, the home frequency basically is the highest frequency that your soul has been able to access in all of its incarnations and so forth, because each and every incarnation, each and every experience it has, its frequent band of frequency raises. So when you're saying you're connecting to your home frequency, that is the new set point, the highest state of home frequency that you have as a baseline, but you're always constantly growing. What happens is that when we get caught up in playing whatever game we're playing in the human or whatever it is, we drop that. So that's why you want to activate the highest home frequency. But each time you do so, it's going to go up anyways, because even your experience on the planet, every time you have a high, you're adding to that home frequency anyways, because you are, as a soul recorder, receiving a higher range of that frequency. So that's what it is. Now, it doesn't limit, because there's two. If you're talking about the human entity is going to have the highest frequency that the human experience has ever achieved. When you go to your soul, multidimensional soul home frequency, you're now the frequencies that it's gained on all of the different dimensions, all the different incarnations, mm-hmm. different connections and so forth, including planet Earth frequency, all blended together. And what is the highest range that was achieved in that state? That's kind of what that means. And then when you're connecting with your highest version of yourself, meaning the highest version of your human experience, because you will notice sometimes you feel so uplifted, so supercharged, so clear, you're setting a new level of what you can call version of yourself. Okay, that continues to upgrade. But then if you have emotional charges, you have negative interactions, or you start to create different personas of yourself and so forth that operates at a lower bandwidth, then you have a lower version of yourself. Mm-hmm. But the reason we create those lower versions is because we want to go play with people that are in that range. So the point now, the push that's for everybody is to get rid of all those ranges and only be in one range. And that is that constant expanding range. So you're accessing the highest version of yourself and then you go beyond that. So that means it doesn't matter where you play, where you do, what you don't do with any interaction, you're always going in with the highest version of yourself rather than saying, okay, I'm going to go see my family now. And now I got to play at their level. So now I can't be myself. I have to take on this other persona. I got to lower my frequency because they won't accept me or something of that nature. And that's what I mean. So you bring in the highest version of yourself. And then at the same time, you could also tap into your highest level of accessible sourceness, meaning your source essence, that high full spectrum. But the highest that you can now use in this human experience. So those are just things that you're basically connecting. All of it exists in you. It's not outside of you. Okay. Nothing's outside of you. Everything's mm-hmm. within you. But what we're doing is activating all of those to the highest range possible. Because once you've done that, you will see that whatever you were getting hung up on, getting caught up on, or feeling lost in, no longer has a grip on you, no longer will seem different. This is why all of a sudden what looks like a anxiety challenge or depression or whatever it is, when you access all of that, it's like, oh, this is a game. Because in that state, you see it as a game. You see it as an opportunity. You see it as a play. Let's go play. Let's go and experience. This isn't a new adventure. We haven't been there before. Let's see what we can do next. And never going in and looking at and saying, oh man, I'm in a hole, whatever it is. Yeah, you can have that experience and then look, oh, that's a pretty cool hole. Now let's see what we can do with this. Let's go and play, right? And
yeah, I like that.
And that's kind of the thing. The other thing I wanted to talk about that you brought up, if you don't mind, was the thing about, you know, what we were talking about, associating from past lives and so forth, yeah, and actually reducing ourselves. But there's also this association about channeling, like you said, you know, if we connect with saying, okay, Jesus or whoever, right, at this point in time. There are aspects of ourselves, but the one message that comes super strong is never to abandon ourselves to any of that. You're not here to be them. They may be sharing, which is another aspect of you, their awareness, whatever it is, but it's like, you taught, you go be taught. You go be the new human. You go be the advanced human that you are. And if I share anything, it's just to trigger what you already know, but go out and play. So it's not about, because a lot of people get caught up in losing themselves to a channeling, to mm-hmm. some other connection. Say, oh, well, I'm special because I channel Jesus, for example. Mm-hmm. Jesus, I channel Mother Mary or whatever, you know, I'm just,
this is good stuff. This is very good stuff.
And people get lost in that. But mm-hmm. what are they losing? They're losing themselves. They didn't come mm-hmm. here to do that. That information is just only to trigger. But you are here to be you and mm-hmm. you to unpack that, nothing and nothing more. I remember some years ago, just to throw this in, you know, AA, you know, people that drink, you know, have to go on that. And I remember the first time, this is like decades ago. I've never been there myself personally, but I've heard other people because I had, you know, people that I was assisting that talked about it, you know, and when they go there, they associate two things. I said, well, that's a pretty, you know, the moment you go in and you're about to speak, you're going to say, I am an alcohol, alcoholic. Yeah. I am an alcoholic. Right. And then you see yourself weak and now you're giving yourself to some other form or other energies, like in that time it was like God or whatever, you know, something stronger, bigger and stronger than you. But you know what I said is you remind them that you are not the alcohol. You're having that experience, mm-hmm. but you're now here to remind yourself that you're more than that, and you're going to start to express that. And the thing is, the changes are not 20 years, 30 years, or whatever amount of time, because you keep going back into that. You make really huge shifts by just reminding yourself you're more than that. And it's not about, oh, you know, there's something bigger than me. I am that bigger, and I choose to exercise that bigger state of myself. Mm-hmm. And that's it. That is empowerment. You're no longer a victim to alcohol. You're no longer a victim to some deity or anything of that nature. You're basically, you are the so-called God or whatever people like to associate, but that source is that essence. And now you're coming from that empowered state. And I noticed that people would shift a lot quicker through it in no time, because all you're doing is reminding them who they are. And so the reason I'm saying that is because it's all interconnected, because we give ourselves away, which is a great experience. But the thing is, as long as we stay there, we never get to flourish to the degree that we're capable of and what we came here to do in the first place.
Well, that's a great example. It's a great metaphor and analogy too for what you were talking about earlier, because number one, what was the field of consciousness? And I can go to this because I've been to many of those meetings. I was forced to for 2 years, but I noticed that right away too. And just to give it its props, the fourth step is to take a fearless moral inventory, which I had done before I ever walked in there. And that's certainly something that helps everybody. But going back to what you were saying earlier, you know, whether it's Todd 10 years ago or Todd 10 incarnations ago, what was the field of consciousness as a whole at the time I entered that field? And again, with your description of what these session-esque stories is, that it's there again as a tool to take you to another level of awareness. And what you're describing is, you know, somebody on a personal level. But again, this is also applicable, like you said, you know, in regard to where we've been in our soul lineage, what skills and abilities we picked up and experiences we've had. And again, it goes back to this, you know, like I wrote this morning, you know, detaching from all belief systems. You could put a lot of different words there, you know, not just of this earth either, but everything. So you're detaching from all of this because it's not me, it's limiting me, whether it's a previous incarnation on Venus or whether it's me 10 years ago in AA meetings. But at the same time, I'm open to everything. You know, I mean, that just seemed, the way I actually wrote that this morning was, until you release every angel and embrace every devil and they all become one. Because, and I didn't want to put it out that way because I figured people might, you know, get triggered by the use of the words and not understand it if they took it too literally. But, you know, I can see this openness that is, you know, we think of openness like, oh, I'm open to this and I'm open to that. But there's another part of it that I'm watching happen, obviously with myself and with the work I do, and that is the deconstruction of our attachment to everything from I'm masculine, feminine, I'm Mother Mary's daughter, I'm you know, all these different things, to include, in my opinion, light language, you know, sacred song. I mean, I can bust them out when I just know I'm supposed to, whatever. I mean, anything and everything. I'm even looking at this the last few days. We talked about music a little while ago, and I have 100 SoulSpeak music videos that I did, and I enjoyed doing them. And they were phenomenal experiences for me, and whatever they did for other people, right? That wasn't the point. But for me to go back, and attempt to do that, as I've tried several times over the last 2 years, is fucking impossible. Mm-hmm. It's gone. Now, I may get into an incarnation in another universe somewhere down the road and have a memory of those incredible nights in the old studio. And from that energy, from that experience, be able to pull something in that will probably be unconscious, just a vibration or a frequency that I feel, and create a new creation, you know, a remix, so to speak. And so I get that, you know, and it's it seems like it's happening,
I wrote today by force or by flow that this is happening. And what I find so extraordinary is to see these things happening with those that have been out there. And you've been involved in these communities a lot longer than I have, 3.5 times more. But I'm not sitting here going, oh, wow, look what's happening to him and look what's happening to her. I'm not doing that. I'm looking at it going, holy shit, if this is happening, what's going to happen on the other side of this? What are they going to create? What are we going to create as we detach from those things that woke us up? Because they're just as much a handicap as a trauma, if we stay connected to it in terms of our identification. So this is a big, big, for my opinion, a huge sign, a huge omen, a huge sign of a I don't know, a major expansion. I don't know if it's the event, but I mean, this is what I call, you know, the humble pie being served, to be funny, because, you know, we do tend to, we have tended to take ourselves a little too seriously, you know, with what we are or what we have been. Right. To, again, going back to what you're saying, just to conclude it, which takes away from what is the purpose, which is if we get, you know, too impressed with what we've remember, so to speak, we don't appreciate what we have, so to speak, and we can't maximize the potential of the expansion of this experience, which can be said a lot of different ways.
Yeah, and the thing is, you said the perfect word, the purpose. Okay, the question we have to ask ourselves when we're reflecting back on an old memory or an old situation, and it doesn't matter if it's on planet Earth, which it in most cases will be, but also on other planets or wherever other incarnation. The question you have to ask yourself, what was the purpose? What was my purpose then versus what my purpose is now? So don't, you know, one thing we have to keep in mind, we don't have one fixed purpose. We have stages of it. Mm. Okay. So we're shifting. So some people are, you know, I used to say to people and all the time, well, I don't know what my purpose is. Well, you're going through many stages of these purpose. One purpose is learning certain things, share certain things or whatever it is. And you go on to the next and the next and the next. So at that point, you needed to be on the streets. So what was my purpose there? Have that experience, connect with certain individuals to be able to, you know, unpack that part of it. Great. Then it changed. My purpose is now assisting people or interviewing people or sharing things and talking about my experiences and relating with whatever. So your purpose changes. Your purpose can change again later on. If, you know, I'm not saying to specifically everybody, you know, different roles. I've gone through the same thing. Other people have gone through the same thing. So we can't get lost in it. But the question at the time when we're looking back at our life and we seem to identify with it or grab it and hold on to it, what was my purpose then? You know? Oh, well, you know, I needed to have that experience. I wanted to learn from it. What did I get from it? What's my gem from there? And then move on. That's the point. It's not to glamorize it, not to hide behind it. A lot of people do, you know, but that eventually is going to get uncomfortable because that's what's happening. Mm-hmm. It's like associating that, oh, I went through this period of my life and now this is who I am because of that period of my life. And I can't do anything more because I went through that period of my life. You look at that life and say, wow, what a cool creation. Yeah, I may have seen the least amount of myself in that experience, but look at what I've learned from that. Now, how do I utilize it now and move forward? So it's, you know, it's...
There's like many lives in even this life.
Right? Oh, absolutely.
You know, and it, thank you for another, that. You know, and another thing too that I see happening, which is, I guess, part of the same thing and that you're talking about is the adamancy of my purpose, right? Like I'm here to interview people five, you know, three shows a day for the rest of my life as a human. Bullshit. I can see that, you know, I can see that coming to an end at some point. Mm-hmm. But it doesn't mean that just like in these previous incarnations in off planet and on planet, that experience, that wealth of coding and knowledge is still there. And so it will serve at somewhere, but it is also being expanded, you know, and it maybe not even by me, by someone else. I look at these essences like I often look at Yeshua, which has been a prominent essence in many people's lives, right? My own, yours. And I think, what is that? You know, was that a man that was born and then walked the earth? Or was it, what, you know, when we know it was, what was it before it came in? And what has become of it? Because it's not, you know, it makes sense that everything is everything. And you can see throughout history, regardless of how that story's and that person's been presented, that there is a congealment of some type of expansion from that consciousness or that energy that in human terms, many, many people have contributed to. Mm-hmm. You know, you could even look like at the story of Paul, or you could look at, you know, just different. We were talking the other day about A Course in Miracles. Somebody writes the book, Marianne Williamson becomes a student of that book, and then she writes a bunch of books from her experience. You know, so you can see how that works. Mm-hmm. But to your point, just to say it one more time, everything, okay, we'll use me as an example. Soulogy was given to me 10 years ago. In the literal form, you know, Jesus, Mary, six prophets, and Archangel Michael walked in the door and said, hey, here's something for you. Okay. Well, it was obviously a divine episode that was substantiated by continuing divine episodes and messages to this day. But that doesn't mean that the day's going to come or not come that I'm going to walk out the door and say, I'm done, you know? So
you're the one that says that it's done too.
Right. But, and so even these things that we feel we were brought here to do, and we're absolutely, oh, this is what I do. Everything is everything, and everything is up for, well, it's not even up for it. Everything changes, everything expands. I'd say the expands to me feels more resonant than, but I guess changes if you want to get literal, but it's expansion.
Yes,
it's an expansion. What happens to
this? All leads back. One thing you just said. This all leads back to where we started the conversation. It all leads back to the fact of, doesn't matter what your purpose is. Your main purpose is to be the grandest human there is under your guidance and expansion.
Yeah, that's beautiful.
That's the main thing. All the other stuff is like saying, okay, these are some of the things that come in. So it doesn't matter what you come in. And I remember this came right from Yeshua when I was like, before I was 4 years old, okay? He said to me at the time, he said, you're here first and foremost to experience and be the human. The grandest human that you can, like everybody else. And he said this to everybody, and it's even in some of the documents saying, you know, you can do everything that I've done and more. Why? Because the more is the fact that I only showed you a sampling based on the state of consciousness of the collective of everything of 2,000 years ago. Mm. But that's growing and evolving, and now more than ever at such neck-breaking speeds, right? But at the same time, this is why it's more, because it never was to be limited and saying, okay, this is what I can do, but you know, you can't, or anything of that nature. Yeah, I think at one point, I don't know if it's in, I don't remember all the writings, but he did say, we're all gods and we're our everything, you know, just as a reference point of
absolutely. Work. Absolutely. It's all over the place. And absolutely. I've never resonated ever with we're returning to the original blueprint. I've always just innately known that's a marker. That's like a symbolic block of energy that we build off of. I mean,
yeah, and any interconnection, genetic and otherwise, for example, even with the DNAs coming back online, don't think it is the DNAs that the DNA, those particular DNAs and the energies it carries, the consciousness it carries, the genetic genomes and everything else that it carries, and the expressions it carries, and the level of communication is the same as 10,000 years ago when it got turned on. Mm-hmm. It is so different because of why? It's not stagnant. It just keeps advancing.
I got you. So I got you. I get what you're saying. Yeah.
Even the blueprint, you're going to, and this is one of the things, I had done some workshops on the restoration of the blueprint, but that was just the layout, but it's never the same. And I always used to say, we're in the upgraded version of it, of the design, because it could not go back to that. Because
yeah, things so are like changing. it was Windows at, let's say, whatever, 5, 10,000, whatever years ago, it was Windows 1. And now we're at Windows 111. So I get it. Yeah, so it's not just, the field of consciousness in that particular place at that time. It's actually, I guess, for lack of a better word, the vehicle at that time. Everything's getting upgraded proportionate to the experience.
Everything. Well, and even, you know, when we say we remember, okay, we're here to remember. Mm-hmm. That's not quite true. While we're having the experience, we're remembering that we're more than the experience. But we're not remembering where we started from. We're accessing the highest version of whatever is going on. Because one of the things that I'm sure many people have come to that conclusion a long time ago or understanding is that even if we become oneness as source, for example, because there are different tiers of oneness, but that sourceness is not, that sourceness is not stagnant. Sourceness is always growing, 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 expanding, mm-hmm. expanding. The field is the same way. Everything is always, nothing is constant, nothing. The only thing that's constant that people like to refer as constant is that it's constantly growing, constantly expanding, constantly, you know, the only constant there is. It's not like, even when the source created two states of itself. There was the field, which basically is sourceness, and then it created what we call spirit, which is still sourceness, but sourceness in creation, sourceness in action, sourceness in whatever, which we all are. As long as we're projecting a form, as long as we're seeing ourselves on a playground, as long as we are evolving in role-playing or whatever it is, we're the spirit part of it. But we're still source at the same time. So the source is the background that holds everything together, but that is not stagnant. It's always constantly mm-hmm. growing all the time. Every part of us is mm-hmm. so you can't mm-hmm. lock it up. And this is why people feel uncomfortable when they still continue to associate with who they thought they were or whatever thing. So even saying, well, I was the king of Sheba or whatever, I was this, you know, I was Simon in biblical times, whatever, you know, and I was playing this role, whatever it was. You can't connect with that. That was like a drop in, play that experience, whatever it was, you've moved on. Things have changed so much that there's not even a sliver of resemblance. Now, one thing I also wanted to share is that people say, well, you know, we live in the past and the future. Well, you don't. You can't. Because it's only now. But what we are doing, even when we try to remember or we have a fixation to a past experience, That past doesn't exist. It dissolves the moment we shift, okay? What happens is we have a memory and we're trying to replicate that past. But I can tell you right now, that replication cannot be replicated exactly the same, because when it was originally experienced, that memory, and where we are now, the field has changed so much. The playground of planet Earth has changed. The human experience has changed. The solar system, the galaxy, the universe, everything has changed. So you're just trying to relive or recreate that as a memory, but it's so disconnected from the illusion that it is such a, and then it's only the ego that loves to kind of regurgitate and bring it up to a day, but it's not trying to bring the old memory or the past. It's the label that that past got attached to. That mm-hmm. I mean,
it's like the, you know, it's like the same energy of this plandemic. They're not going to kick us off for that, but because it's like that whole let's return to normal.
Right.
Well, I remember my kid was probably 2.5 or 3, and so I would have been in my late 30s. I was working at one of my offices in San Antonio, and we were passing through town, and my wife at the time took my kids to the local swimming pool, the public pool. So the kid has floaties on and decides he wants to be like the big kids, takes them off and jumps in. And he left his body, angel came, and it was a beautiful experience. But when I got the news, I was in the office and I jumped in the truck and I'm driving to the hospital. I had a couple of friends of mine, a couple of managers were driving to the hospital. And I remember being in this state of gratitude, and just my soul has always been present. I just went, I am so grateful for the experience of being with this soul. And and so to me, that's what that's all about. You know, to me, if I was in the galactic war, or if I was something on this planet or that planet or whatever, it's just gratitude. It's information, it's gratitude for the experience, it's a gratitude for life. Because to me, you know, we can talk all day long, but there's one thing that is constant, and that is living life. Yep. What is that? Well, what is that is, you know, I hate to sound like a human self-help guru, but what is that? That is what we make it, which is kind of going back to what you said earlier about all of us diving in deep and getting into the extreme. And I think Earth must be a very good example because of the swiping of the memory and the extremity of the polarity, you know, is such, I mean, you have more recollection by far, but I can't even imagine a playground like this. Mm-hmm. This is like mind blowing.
Oh, absolutely. And, I agree with you.
And especially now, where so a lot of the, you know, a lot of the essences are aspects that we interact with, you know, like somebody has a near death or out of body, you know, there's this field of consciousness that we enter, or we whatever, that's just like, wow, you know, peace, love, you just, you know what I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. So then you have these galactic aspects that don't have the empathy. These aspects of ourselves don't have the empathy. They're more mechanical. They're more nuts and bolts, you know. Not that they don't have divine love and unconditional love. It's not that. It's just from the human perspective, both ways. So my question is, it feels to me, and we talked about this earlier, but it feels to me like the emotions are unique to us in some way, and I'm talking to the human species, they're like this new raw material for the advancement and expansion of the universe's experience. And it to me feels like it's not written yet. Mm-hmm. Like it feels like, what can we do with this when we stop crying on the pity pot and stop externalizing as we're evolving and it's happening? How far can we take this? Because it seems like that there's a tremendous amount of energy in what we would call our emotional intelligence or emotional quotient. I don't know. I find that the biggest expressions that I've had, let's say on myself, and what, let's just say, on what I can see in terms of my brothers, sisters, for something I might put out or be involved in. When the emotions are involved, it's like night and day. In fact, it's a similar situation to what you were talking about, these memories, you know, what I was saying about the gratitude, or you were talking about, how do you capture that? Well, you can't capture that, because, right, like you were saying, and I find myself in this, I don't know if I want to say this, if it's right, but like a chase, like I'm playing with this ball. Mm-hmm. And I'm learning how to play with it. And sometimes it gets blown by the wind, like a beach ball going down the beach, and I go grab it again, and it's never the same, but there is one constant, some kind of fusion between this incarnation as a human, I guess the human entity, the human experience, and my soul. There's like something new, like it's fascinating to me. Now, do I want to go through deep levels of sadness or some of the things that have inspired the great artists all over the world? Not really. I haven't had enough of that. I don't need to do that. And it feels like something that's there to play with. I don't know.
Absolutely. Great observations there. And the thing is, too, one of the things that while you were talking about this whole idea of this fixation on the, you know, the Akashic records or anything of that nature, those are just the collections of experiences and so forth. It's not a reference point where we have to do it. So for even when we look at history of any sort of form and saying, well, you know, we have to look at our history so we don't repeat it. Well, or the fact of who did what happened in, 1935 or whatever it is. You know, any of those associations at this point in time is really just keeping us in that kind of stuck state. So it's like, we are here now. What have we learned? Where are we in our awareness? And what do we feel from it within to create as a collective? So that, because it's not about, you know, creating another environment where we can better survive. It's about creating an environment, which is our natural state, is how can we best flourish? Mm-hmm. How can we best create an environment where we can be ourselves? How can we create the best environment for that we can continue to explore and experience ourselves in the grandest form that we are, and be the grandest state of human that's always evolving, always expanding, and so forth, you know? And this is the thing. So looking back at the history, so well, we have to look at history not to repeat it. Well, why would you repeat any part of it? Because in essence, that was just that experience. It's like for yourself. I mean, I think you said that you were in the financial world years ago, many years ago?
Corporate world.
Thank you. Okay. So it's like somebody saying, well, you know, hey, Todd, I know you're living day by day now or whatever it is through contribution, but you're doing this work. Why don't you come and join the corporate world? We're going to pay you $250,000 per year and whatever else. And, just come on back, because I know you can do a fantastic job. And it comes to that point and you say, wow, okay, that's alluring and everything else, but can I actually go do it? Can I actually see myself going back to that world, go back there, even though the carrot is like $250,000 and, you know, all of a sudden you can, you know, get your own house, get whatever, you don't have to live that life. You will notice And I'm not here to answer you, the question for you, because you know it already and I can sense it. And, but this is for anybody else, because I've had to face that myself. Mm. It's like you look at it and you go, yeah, that was great then, but I can't do that now. You couldn't do it. It didn't matter if they paid you $1 million a year, if they paid you $10 million a year, because it's, even if you even attempt it for a few days or whatever else, you're going to find yourself so out of that state. Why? Because that is not for you to repeat, because this is what you've created. You've come here to do something grander than all of that. And this is where we have to continue moving, where people have to say, all right, I am here where I am. It doesn't matter what, who played what, who did what occurred or didn't occur, who I identified as myself before, whatever it is. What do I choose and feel from my pure state to represent, to experience, to expand in this beautiful journey? I am here now because this is for me now. And the thing is, there is no future, because why, how could you create a future when you're always constantly expanding? You know, when I used to say for people, when I said this years ago, people thought I was totally out of my freaking mind. You know, here's the statement. The statement was, you've got to have your long-term and short-term goals, and you got to map out your life. Like, I don't even know what tomorrow is going to look like, you're telling me to. But I can say, I would like to intend to get to this point, but I have to keep it open, totally flexible. Because whatever I am designing right now, if I sat down and wrote my goals, that is currently the way I can see it. Tomorrow, 1 hour from now, a week from now, my viewpoint, my focus, even my purpose would redefine or expand or refine even differently and see how any of that fits in. It doesn't. This is why you need to be in fluidity. This is why you need to be in a state of complete openness and take the grandest state of yourself each moment and creating another moment, brand new. Because each moment that you live it fully, this is the thing, is a lot of people talk about living in the moment, but are they really living in the moment? Are they in the moment thinking of the past and the future? Are they in the moment looking at their lives and saying, oh, this is who I am? You cannot relate yourself to say who I am. I am pure potentiality. I am pure source essence expressing itself each moment. And then you're in the moment in its true form. Because now nothing, there's no future, no past. I'm living it. And as I'm living it, I'm expanding it. And as I expand it, I'm just going to continue creating new levels. This is our source nature. This is our human nature. This is our true design. But it has no patterns. It has no limits. It has no, it needs to be one way or another. This is the beauty once we understand that, see it more fully. And this is what people are starting to see now, you know, more clearly. And that's what's going to perpetuate us to move through all of this currently. So if you get together, you know, with a group of people, say, okay, let's see what we can do now with what we've gained and experienced, not only in this life, but in any other life, meaning even in other dimensions. What's possible? I know, like when I refer to any embodiment in other planets, I'm not there to replicate it. I'm there to see, wow, that was possible there. Does it even apply here? Can we make it possible here? But not possible in the same way, in the human way, in the what we have here in this playground.
It's a point of context.
Right.
It's a point of contact. It's a rhythm. It's a, you know, like, you know, this stuff, there's that innate thing, right? You know, and so every soul, like you say, every soul has a signature. And I guess that's a pattern or a character makeup, however you want to put it, personality, somehow cosmically, whatever. But I really get that. Like, things look a certain way on the surface, but beneath it, there's a certain makeup to it. And it takes on all these different forms in the different playgrounds. But it's really, I know what my, I know that part of me. I can't prove it to anybody, but I know it involves like color and vibration and frequency and geometry and somehow how, you know, like you described earlier, which I always say here, when it is, you know, we're adding frequencies to an ever expanding vibration. So how did you say that a minute ago? Like the spirit is the frequencies, you know.
Yeah, it's being highest added,
the source is the vibration, right? It is what it is. And so now what you're talking about is this whole thing of what is the moment, you know? I mean, you can't fake it. You know, I'm watching it happen, like even today. So I sent you a message. There was no timeline on it, mm-hmm. right? And you sent me one back, say, hey, what about this time? Now I'm going to bed at 9:30 thinking, how the hell am I going to get up at 4? But there was something in me that just said, you know, I'll message you when I get up. I didn't say I'll make it. I had a feeling I would, but the less I say, the better I am, because the more I'm in the moment. The more I say, the more I define what isn't going to happen in the moment, right? So at the same time, I had scheduled something with a lady that had written about wanting to tell her hero's journey, and somehow or another, it didn't work. I messed it up. So I just happened to, you know, and the same thing happened. It wasn't like, you know, let's do it on this day. It was just like, hey, here's my number, and let's do this. And then she writes back, you know, as I'm coming out of the sleep and you know, getting ready to get up at 2:00. And I said, hey, you want to do it today? She's like, oh, okay, let's do it today. And I said, well, I'm available between, you know, like 3 and 6 your time. She's in Alaska. And she writes back and says, yeah, between 3 and 6 is good for me. So there wasn't like this, okay, what time I need to know. You know what I mean? I can see it happening. And I keep going back to the same thing. This is either going to be in every moment by force or by flow, right? I always say let go or be dragged is in proverb, but there is an element of that. Mm-hmm. And you know, if there's anything that I, you know, like remind myself every day in so many different ways, because it all leads to the same thing, which is being in the moment, which is, you know, be real with yourself. Don't judge yourself. You know, I went and got a, you know, I've been juicing every day, but I went and got a, I couldn't wait. And I went and got a roll and a piece of pizza from the little corner store. And I enjoyed it. Okay. I did. I really enjoyed it. And then I thought, and then when I was done, I thought my body, you know, I talked to my body. My body says, you know, that's going away. You can't be doing that. The juicing's great, but that's not going to work. You know,
yeah.
I get that, but I enjoyed it. There was no judgment. Mm-hmm. But I guess what I'm trying to say is this, Todd, and it doesn't happen a lot, Franco, but like if you start to get out of the lines, it's like, Todd, just relax, dude. You know, like this is the best thing you can do is just chill, take a breath, and see what you can dive into, right? Talk to Franco, see what happens. I had no agenda here. I had an inkling of something, which turns into this, right? Which is, that's the beauty of it. You know, you go in with a, you know, it's kind of like that inch mile thing. You go in with an inch and you come out with a mile.
Yep.
And it's it's a beautiful.
Yeah, we never know how things are gonna play out, unpack, whatever it is. You just go ready to be open for it and let it take its own course, because we're basically navigating it, but we also know exactly what it would be best each step of the way. And this is the thing, is like, you know, you have an intent, and you know, and that's great. Let's see how it all unpacks. You go and let it just take its own course. And the course is really, it's your navigation, but you're navigating from a higher state. And you see, we're not limited to just our highest state, or what we can call our highest consciousness or being or whatever beingness. we don't do anything as a fragment. We do it as a whole. So that means if we're playing here as the human, anything and everything that we're going to do will be not only for just Todd and Franco having this discussion, but it not only impacts the collective, but the people that need to hear this verbally in this conversation that we're having is going to be hearing it. And it's exactly what they need, because it's going to trigger what they already were kind of playing in the background with themselves and couldn't put the pieces together. It's like, yes. Okay. Right. So yeah, I mean, we were going
to happening. That's happening a lot too. That sequential, that sequential aspect to it. You know, I always refer it to like a book. Yeah. And they look like two unrelated incidents, or, you know, and you turn the page and it's like, oh, it's just like really cohesive more and more every day. Yeah. And it's an amazing thing. I'm gonna have to go because I got something to do in 15 minutes. But
yeah, we can cut it off anytime you want.
Yeah, so. But I wanted to ask you. Oh, I know what it was. I might have asked you this on the show the other day, but I don't think so. I know I started to, and then we probably got off on a tangent. But like, okay, so what is it? It's September the 12th. Mm-hmm. And even the thought, would take me out of the moment, but I'm doing this from like an intrigue standpoint.
Yep.
Like, what the hell by December 31st? Like, I can just feel this. This is like, it's so rapid. Every point of context that I look at is, if I look away and look back, it's changed. Whether it be Joe Biden at a press conference or me talking to the tree like we were talking the other day. But it's seriously, I mean, it's like warp speed beyond warp speed. And it's just like fascinating to me. And I don't really need to think about it, or even like to get in depth with it, if you don't feel it's necessary, it doesn't have to, but it just certainly feels that way. And I guess that's a knowing. Yeah. And the best thing I can do, I guess, if I use that let's just say, if I just put it on myself solely, is just like the tail appearing in the bed. Oh, is that a reptilian or a dragon? Oh, well, it doesn't matter. It's behind me. It's gone.
Yeah.
Right. Because it's a hindrance.
Yeah. It's just moving through you, and it's not there to identify, associate, or label, or define, or anything of that nature. And that's the thing. So yeah, like you're saying, things are speeding up immensely. The thing is, we don't know where it's going to go and how we're going to go, because we're basically creating each moment. But at the same time, we have intent as a collective. We have our own personal intent and certain intents to make massive amount of progress. How is it going to take? How is it going to play out? Who's going to play the roles? It doesn't matter if it's negative or positive at this point in time, as people like to associate with. It's going to be whatever it's going to be, and it's going to be exactly what is necessary and beneficial to really move things in a powerful way. So yesterday we started on another pulse that's going to go right to the 22nd before the 21st, and then the 22nd we have another pulse. But each one of this is just really just bringing things even further and further and further away, further and further expedited in a way. And the thing is, we can't lose our perspective that it's not about arriving anywhere by a certain time. It's about being part of every step of the journey.
Mm-hmm. And it's not about, with this new wave, not the wave you're, not the pulsations you're talking about, but mm-hmm. what I was telling you on that show when we started, and what I was telling you when we started this one, which is the new, I don't want to demean anything, mm-hmm. but I would say like the newest lightworker fad. It was the big solar flash and the event, and now I can see one building, and it's got this element of being done. Oh, we got there. Oh, it's over. And I'm going, that just doesn't fit.
it doesn't.
You know, that takes away from why I'm here. And it, yeah, I mean, I'm really going deep with this within myself. Both in regard to my role, which I take very seriously, and you know, as I do my own, because it, to me, it's all the same thing, responsibility, you know, as a conscious creator.
But to the point where I go, well, you know, I can always just jump in the car and grab a tent, go find a mountain somewhere by a lake. And, you know, in other words, I can do whatever I want to.
Right. You know what I mean? Exactly. Yes. Yes.
Yeah. I don't have to buy into it. So again, that kind of goes back full circle too, to what I was asking about this little morsel that I couldn't find, which was actually not the point. The point was I was attached to the fact that there was a morsel I couldn't find.
Great.
So if I get attached to, and this is a good one too, because it's all, you know, that whole thing about, oh, they're not awake and oh, this and oh, that. Well, it doesn't matter what this and that are. It's my attachment to this and that. Exactly. I'm missing this.
Yep.
And who I want to play with.
Yep.
Right. Or who's mutually aligned with me. We're so close, but so far, you know. I mean, it's like, it's so funny because it's always right in front of your face, right? And it's a beautiful thing. Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah, this is cool. I enjoyed this. I do. I do really. It's a really deep thing to be a human. And if I'm going to speak for myself, but if I allow myself to be that. So when I say to you, you know, you two are my best friends besides Morgan, that's a different, you know, this is the human. I mean, that's like, I can feel that in my chakra, you know, I don't really go for that stuff, but I can feel it in my body, right? I can feel my body saying, yes, it's okay. You can do that. You can express yourself. You can tell Franco and Kimberly how much you love them, you know? And,
thank you.
It's so.
We love you too. I mean, we've, since the first time we've connected, I felt the connection with you and, like a brother I've never had in a sense in the human sibling version, because it, you know, my relationship with my brothers are very different.
Well, join the club. No, but, one I'm in pretty good shape with, but the other one, though. All right.
You know, as the wrap up, the thing is too, yes. The thing is to be the grandest human that you can be, but knowing at the same time, you're not confound or not restricted to the human, and you're more than the human, because it's like, I'm taking on a human expression experience at this point in time and bring it to the highest of evolutionary state of it or capacities, but also knowing that I'm more than that. And the thing is that, and this is why it's necessary to drop all the other versions of them, a dragon of this and that, or whatever it is, because it's not about that. When you are in that form, and when you, even if it's a parallel version of that form, when you're present there, you're having that experience and you're evolving that experience, but you're at the same time more than that, and now you're human, or having the human expression experience, and now I'm going to evolve the human, but I know that I'm more than the human. It's just not to minimize yourself, but at the same time not to discount yourself, because a lot of people like to disconnect from their role. It's like, you come here to play the role, be the role, but yeah. Be in this grandest form of it. That's all.
Yeah, I say all along, the minute we get out of here, we're going to wish we'd stayed longer and done more.
Yes, exactly. Exactly.
All right. Cool. Well, do whatever you want with this. You should put it out. If you put it out, give me access to the
link. I'm going
to
send you the recording and you can do whatever you want with it.
Well, you put it out too.
I will put it out too.
Okay. You're going to put it out. And then, since we're not in, you know, I was very attached to the strategic planning and all that. I took a bath in that. But I feel that alignment, some type of that is, you know, with everything else. Maybe we can talk about the, I don't know, maybe the words are consolidation, distribution, and maybe it's just taking care of itself, right? Mm-hmm. So, because I do see that in your numbers, I keep it, and in Soulogy's numbers, it's gotten quite interesting the last few weeks. Mm-hmm. But yeah, send it to me and I'll put it out there and maybe run it as a live and put it out on all the platforms.
Yeah, absolutely.
Y'all take care. Y'all take care and good luck on your move. Let me know what's happening. And hey, we can text.
Absolutely. And there's no problem texting to United States because it's all covered in the package. So it's not, there's no extra charge.
Evidently my new phone is too. So that's great for me.
Okay, cool. All right. Take care. Love you, brother.
All right, man. See you later.
See ya.
Okay, bye-bye. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Franco. Thank you, Kimberly. See y'all later.